Hey there, and welcome back to another video devotional, or as I like to call them, videvos, where we are continuing our study in the book of Romans. And we've reached chapter 7, where Paul is addressing the believers in Rome, and he kind of starts off in verse 1 with a rhetorical question, talking to the believers. Notice here in verse 1 through 3, he says, "Or do you not know, brothers, for I am speaking to those who know the law, that the law is binding on a person only as long as he lives? For a married woman is bound by law to her husband while he lives, but if her husband dies, she is released from the law of marriage. Accordingly, she will be called an adulteress if she lives with another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband dies, she is free from that law. And if she marries another man, she is not an adulteress." Paul starts with this example of marriage. And before we were a believer, before we decided to follow Christ, we were kind of connected or married to a past life that could not live up to the law that God set before us. And when we came to trust in Jesus, we died to that life. We put that law, that life in the past. But I don't want you to confuse where Paul says that we have died to the law to mean that the law no longer has authority. More so, we've been set free from a certain death because the law that we can't keep without Christ has condemned us to death. Check out verse 4 and 5. "Likewise, my brothers, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ." Not our own works, through Christ's sacrifice, through his body. And continues, "so that you may belong to another." He's kind of going back to that whole marriage thing. You've died to your past life, so you now belong to Christ because you've died to that past life. "So you may belong to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that we may bear fruit for God. For while we were living," notice we were, that's past tense there, "while we were living in the flesh, our sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit for death." While we were still living in the flesh, our sinful passions and our past lives that we were bonded to before deciding to follow Jesus. Look at verse 6. "But now we are released from the law, having died to that which held us captive, so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of the written code." We're released from that law that held, that not the law, but the sin that held us captive. The sin that held us under that guilt and the shame, we're released from that through Christ's sacrifice. You know, if you stood before a judge and the judge ruled you not guilty, it would be a pretty good feeling. But that doesn't bring death to the law that brought us before the judge in the first place. I'm sure you've all been to the dentist, and sometimes when you go to the dentist, they have these little chewables that you chew up, and it kind of reveals the plaque in your teeth and stuff like that, maybe spots you might have missed brushing. Now, the chewable itself, it's not the plaque that's in your mouth, but it reveals it. And in a way, that's the way the law is with us. The law reveals sin in our lives. Look at verse 7. "What shall we say then? That the law is sin? By no means. Yet, if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin, for I would not have known what it is to covet. If the law had not said, 'You shall not covet,' but sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. For apart from the law, sin lies dead. I was once alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin came alive and I died." And in a lot of ways, that's what it is, that we would have no moral guideline if we didn't have the law. We wouldn't understand what sin was. We'd have no clear definition if we didn't have the law. That's why the law is so good and important. And fortunately, through Christ's death and resurrection, it has given us the ability to clean up our lives. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked." Notice that past tense again. "Following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived." There's that past tense. "We all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desire of the body and the mind, and were," past tense again, "by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive, which is a new creation, together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In a way, this kind of leads us back to chapter 6, verse 1. Should we sin more so that grace may increase? By no means. We should be thankful that because of grace, we can be forgiven, and we should do our best, staying close to God, to abstain from sin. Notice in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. I hope this video helped you out, and I hope it can help you go deeper. Check out the follow-up questions afterwards and dive into the scripture yourself. And don't forget to join us for chapter 7, part 2. Thanks, and we'll see you later.